Hi, I'm Brandon Stewart, and I'm an assistant professor in the sociology department. I develop new techniques in an emerging and interdisciplinary field called text as data, an approach for converting collections of documents into data that we can use to learn about the social world. The study of human behavior is changing. In fields like sociology and political science, it used to be that when we wanted to know what people did or how they felt about something, a central approach was to call up a random set of people and give them a survey. This was effective, but also expensive. In the last two decades, things have been changing. There's been an avalanche of new written documents available. Emails, tweets, Reddit posts, press releases, and even books have exploded in record numbers. The space of the commons is changing. These collections contain trillions of words, more verbose than the book collections at the world's largest libraries. Social scientists realized that now they had a new source of information of what people were thinking and feeling, the digital footprints that they left as they lived their lives in print. That is, if they could find a way to turn those trillions of words into usable data. Of course, the kind of public opinion that we find in tweets or Facebook posts is different from the kind of public opinion we get from a telephone survey. It actually harkens back to the pre-telephone notion of public opinion. Not as the private opinions held by the person picking up the phone, but the opinions of those who chose to proclaim their opinion in public. And it isn't just public opinion. Many kinds of information of interest to social scientists are encoded in text. Being able to access it isn't just a change in how we study people, but who we study and what we study. The core ideas in text as data have actually been around for a while. Frederick Mosteller and David Wallace, statisticians at Harvard University and the University of Chicago, published a paper in the Journal of the American Statistical Association back in 1963, entitled Inference in an Authorship Problem. They considered the Federalist Papers, an unsigned collection of 85 documents written by Alexander Hamilton, John Jay, and James Madison about the U.S. Constitution. While all the papers were unsigned at the time of publication, Hamilton and Madison provided conflicting lists of authorship before their death. The result is that while the authorship of 73 of the papers is uncontested, for 12 of the papers, it was a matter of historical debate if they were written by Hamilton or Madison, a debate Mosteller and Wallace set out to resolve. They noticed that Madison and Hamilton wrote in a subtly different style, using filler words like upon, by, from, and to at different rates. They reasoned that if they could identify the typical rate of usage of each of these words from the papers with known authorship, they could identify the authors of the disputed essays based on whether they used those words with the same rates. Crucially, they didn't want to choose words that conveyed the topic of the papers, but rather those that reflected the unconscious stylistic preferences of the authors. At the time, even counting the words proved to be quite challenging. In his autobiography, Mosteller described the process of counting words by typing them on long pieces of paper and then cutting them into tiny one-word strips. When the counting was going on, if someone opened the door, slips of papers would fly around the room. Once they had the counts complete, they used statistical models that were estimated on an IBM 7090, a then brand new computer that filled a room, but which had far less computing power than many people today have in their watches. Once all the work was done, Mosteller and Wallace were able to decisively attribute the authorship of the disputed papers to Madison, a conclusion that matched the consensus of historians. The computing resources of the early 1960s limited these kinds of approaches to only relatively small corpora and well-resourced researchers. Today, we can scale up to even larger collections of documents. In recent US elections, if you went to a rally or to visit the website of a political candidate, you would likely be invited to join an email list. This is an interesting type of communication because it's semi-public. Anyone can sign up to receive a candidate's emails, but unlike television ads or press releases, the emails are not readily available to the public or straightforward for academics to study. During the 2020 US election, I worked with Aranesh Mathur, Arvind Narayanan, and a team of researchers at Princeton's Center for Information Technology Policy to create the largest collection of election-related emails available. We used automated bots to visit all the websites of thousands of candidates for federal and state office and sign up for their email list. We then collected the emails over the course of the campaign and released them, all 435,000 of them, as the Princeton corpus of political emails. You can go have a look at them yourself at electionemails2020.org and search for your own representative or your favorite candidate. With hundreds of thousands of documents, it isn't possible to read every one. So we use statistical topic models to help identify latent themes. Topic models take a collection of documents and return sets of words that communicate a common subject matter, as well as the documents that contain information about those subjects. We can track, for example, the way two parties talk about topics like the COVID-19 pandemic or topics around racism and policing. We didn't know that these were the topics in the emails. They emerged inductively through our analysis. In our case, we use something called the structural topic model, a tool I developed with my colleagues Molly Roberts at UCSD and Dustin Tingley at Harvard. STM, as we call it, works by using the co-occurrence of words to figure out the underlying topics of a document. For example, if the words bat, pitcher, catcher, base, and stadium all frequently occur together in many documents, we might infer that there's a common topic called baseball. Every document is described then as a combination of different topics, so any given document might be 60% about baseball and 40% about entertainment. In the case of the emails, we learned a number of different topics that we grouped into categories like political issues, fundraising, voter mobilization, or ceremonies and holidays. As we read through the emails, we started to notice something a little troubling. A challenge for email senders is that only about 20% of political emails are even opened by recipients. In an attempt to get people to open their emails, senders were resorting to a set of manipulative practices. We decided to characterize and measure some of these practices. We grouped the things we found into two broad categories. One is clickbait. That's using techniques such as sensational headlines or urgent deadlines to create interest. And two are dark patterns, manipulations of the email user interface to trick the recipient. In these example emails, you can see the kinds of things we're talking about. Changing the name of the from field so it isn't clear who it's from, or replacing RE colon in the subject line to make it appear as though the email was a reply to a previous message. We trained a statistical model to measure these tactics in the email corpus and found that they are distressingly common. The median active sender uses them in 42% of their emails, and 99% of the senders use them at least occasionally. We've collected over 400,000 emails. This would be way too much to go through manually and look for this information. Text as data methods both helped us learn what the emails were about, read them more effectively, and characterize the rates at which manipulative tactics were used. Text as data methods are really flexible. They work across languages and can even be used to help make causal inferences. Several years ago, Molly Roberts, Rich Nielsen, and I wanted to study censorship in China. It's been well documented that the Chinese government censors speech on the internet by taking down individual blog posts. But censoring the entire internet is really difficult. The number of bloggers is always going to be much greater than the number of censors. This naturally leads us to wonder about the role that self-censorship might play in the system. That is, if a blogger censored at one time, does it change what they write in the future? This is a difficult causal inference question. People aren't censored at random, so if we simply compared the writing of people who were censored to people who weren't, we would conflate the effect of being censored with the kinds of people who were more likely to write the sort of posts that got censored in the first place. One common strategy in causal inference is to imagine the ideal experiment, even if we can't practically do it, and then try to emulate it with observational data. In such an ideal experiment, we would randomly assign censorship to some posts and not to others, and then follow those bloggers over time. Of course, this has the double problem of being wildly impractical and completely unethical. But what we do instead is try to create the best approximation we can using real data. Using data from 2012, we find pairs of posts written by similar users with similar censorship histories who on the same day write posts with similar content. But one was censored and one was not. That is, we comb through the data to find censorship mistakes. We then compare the outcomes of these pairs of bloggers, and we look at over 75,000 posts using Texas data methods to find these mistakes. Ultimately, we find that the users who were censored have almost double the censorship rate of those who weren't in their posts moving forward, but they still post at the same rate they did before. This suggests that censored bloggers are undeterred by censorship and either still posting on sensitive content or possibly subjected to more intense scrutiny. Texas data methods are reshaping many fields of study, from sociology to political science to medicine. A key part of this is creating open source software that helps other scholars make use of these methods. The STM software, the topic model I mentioned earlier, has been downloaded hundreds of thousands of times and used by academics, businesses, and government agencies to help make sense of the documents of countless communities. This has expanded the range of who we study and what we study and how we study it. These issues, of course, are not without challenges. The ethics of studying large text corpora can be really nuanced. While the things people post on the internet are public, the authors may not realize or consent to their writing being used for academic research, creating questions of what is shared in the common space. The ethical considerations of this kind of work are an active discussion across numerous fields. If you're interested in learning more about this topic, Justin Grimmer, Molly Roberts, and I have a new book from Princeton University Press available in March of 2022 called Text as Data, A New Framework for Machine Learning in the Social Sciences. This is just the beginning of how these methods will change the way we study people.